Dr. Wiseman.
Thank you.
What have we got today? What are we doing?
Okay, today we're going to talk about reading numbers. I don't mean like numerology, like reading the stars or anything. I mean actually seeing a number and reading it and speaking it and the processes that happen when you're doing that. If we're going to talk about reading, then we probably should think about words quickly because we know a whole lot about how we read words. There are two different processes in the brain when we read words. We can either read words that we're familiar with, which are legal words, and those are ones that we have like a long-term memory representation of. So words that you can find in a dictionary.
Go on, give me some.
Cat, lamppost, elephant, tutu. That's a really interesting mental image I've just got there. I don't know where that came from. Those are just four of the many words that are available to you. And we know that people can read those because they see it and they recognize the kind of shape of it and then they produce the noise. They produce the phonological form of that word. However, when you're reading something that's a non-word, like blurglmerge, you're actually doing something very different because you can't recognize it and then produce it. You're actually looking at it letter by letter. So we know that there are two different routes that you can take when reading words and non-words. Now, if we think about it, there is actually an equivalent to this with numbers. Now, your reaction to me saying that is, what's a non-number? Because there's no such thing as a dictionary of numbers. There are infinitely many numbers. I've checked it on Wikipedia. If you go to the list of numbers Wikipedia article, it will tell you that it is an incomplete list. So there are actually, I've double checked, an infinite number of numbers.
If we're going to allow things like blurglmerge, there's probably an infinite number of words.
Blurglmerge is a non-word, so that falls outside of the scope. There is no numerical equivalent to blurglmerge. So what are we actually looking at? The equivalent is whether or not the numbers that you're reading are familiar or meaningful to you, or whether or not they're unfamiliar or meaningless to you. The thing that happens in your brain when you read a number that you're familiar with is different to what happens when you read a number that you are unfamiliar with.
Okay? So it's the same as with the words?
Exactly. There are multiple different routes that you can choose to read a number. So if you ask me how you define a familiar number, the answer is poorly. It's super subjective. There are numbers that are familiar to me that will mean absolutely nothing to you and vice versa. There are a massive set of numbers that culturally we all find familiar. So for example, the year 2015, that's familiar to all of us. But if I was to pick the number 1804, that probably doesn't mean much to you. No, that's because it's my birthday. How dare you not know when my birthday is?
What, as in the 18th or the 4th?
Exactly. Oh, okay. So that number, however, is very familiar to myself. I think the number 1066 is probably a familiar number to most people. However, having had that assumption very confidently around a lot of people, I realised that some people's knowledge of history is not exactly as good as you might imagine.
So I guess numbers that are like titles of films and things like that.
Exactly, yes.
Lower numbers are better for this?
I have done some research on this, and I basically made this survey and got people to just type in a load of numbers that they liked and then assess whether or not they thought they were familiar or random. The distribution was the case that a lot of the lower numbers were very much more familiar to people, and then as you went up in magnitude, the frequency of familiar numbers that you got decreased. However, there were like nice peaks. You get peaks for numbers that look like years. So I wanted to know when the kind of future would end. I think I did this a couple of years ago. So 2013 was a familiar number to people. 14, 15, 16 was, but 2017 people decided was not familiar to them. So it seems
4 years.
Yes, 4 years. That's the end of the future, and people don't care about it after that. It appears. Obviously now you're sitting there thinking, well, 2017 is highly familiar to me. That's because that's 2 years away, and you're in the future now. So there are other things. 90210 is a familiar thing to people, and that's interesting in itself because it began as a zip code, but it probably doesn't mean a zip code to most people. It probably means the TV program. There's a whole load of reasons for numbers to be familiar to us. Okay. Let's explore this. So I said there were multiple different routes. I'm going to give us a start number. So this is the number that we are going to be reading. The most basic thing that we can do with it is we can take it and turn it into its Arabic numeral form. So that is, when we're reading it out, we get out at the end 1989. It has no other meaning beyond it's just a string of digits and they don't interfere with or talk to either of the other digits around it. Very straightforward, obviously. Now, the next thing we can do is we can turn it into its number word form. Now, this is probably going to be a bit contentious. I'm going to turn it into the word form 1989. I say contentious because I think that when you read that number, that is probably not the first thing you go to when you read it as a word. So with the first one, you haven't done any processing on it. You've just gone digit by digit and turned it into its phonological form. Whereas with this second way of processing it, what you've had to do is work out exactly which digit you're reading and also the position of that digit within the number. So this 9 gets read out as 9, whereas this 9 gets joined to the 1 and becomes the number 19. On the mathematical route, this means we might come up with some mathematical facts about the number. So when you read that number, you might say, I know that that number is greater than 1,000. I know that that number is odd. There's a whole load of things you might know. That number represents an amount of something. It has a meaning beyond the first two levels that we talked about.
And it has constituent parts.
Exactly, and it has rules that it adheres to. Up until quite recently, all models of number reading have really just focused on these three levels. We call this one surface reading, and this one is a deeper semantic reading of it. What you've had to do is not just turn that into a phonological form, you've also had to appreciate the kind of meaning behind it and what it actually relates to. There is a fourth level, and this is kind of something that we've only recently started trying to put into models of number reading, and that fourth level is something called an encyclopedic lookup. And this is what happens when the number that you're reading has some position in your long-term memory. That is, when the number that you're reading means something to you, when you've come across it before in some circumstance. So this number, you may have realized, looks quite a lot like a year, for example. 1989, to me, the reason I've chosen it is because that is a personal important number to me, because that is when my sister was born. That's my sister.
Yeah.
Yay. There is also a cultural significance to this year at the moment. Taylor Swift's incredible new album is called 1989.
Is that because she was born in 1989?
I assume so.
Is Taylor Swift your sister?
I've chosen this method to tell everyone that yes, Taylor Swift is my younger sister. So there is this more cultural and kind of shared reason for this number to be familiar to me, you, Brady, I know, and probably millions and millions and millions of other people that have caused this album to be at the number one spot for 10 weeks running or something like that. So you get this cultural significance. Taylor. There are lots of models of number reading, and they haven't really incorporated all of these levels together before. And the reason it's interesting is because we can kind of prove that these levels exist. It might, like I say, it might be kind of obvious to you that you can read these numbers like this, and you're probably not aware of you doing all of these different things. But people that are aware of this are researchers who look at patients with aphasia. Aphasia is a language disorder that is often caused by a brain trauma. And by language disorder, I mean it affects your ability to read. Sometimes it affects your ability to speak, but that's all it does. It doesn't affect your understanding of what you're reading or trying to say. Some people get a specific effect of aphasia on their ability to read numbers. It can kind of take out some of these pathways.
But not all of them?
Not all of them, which is the really, really cool and interesting thing. In this paper, they do this case study, and they look at a man who is 43, and he suffers a brain trauma, and then he develops aphasia as a result of that. This guy, his ability to do that digit-by-digit reading had been lost. And so when he was shown a number that he was unfamiliar with, he couldn't read it out loud. That means this pathway here had been taken out, this pathway here had been taken out as well. So no longer could he rely on just sounding out numbers or producing number words. So he was very interested in racing, rally cars in particular. So he was shown this number. He said, the number of cars that win. It was my first car. It begins with a P. Peugeot, Renault, it's Peugeot. 403, no, 500, 504. So that's how he managed to get to it, because 504 is a brand of Peugeot car that, according to this man, wins. It's the car that wins. And so that shows you exactly how he managed to read it out loud. He went through this encyclopedic stage and found this memory representation of the number and was able to read it out loud.
So if you'd shown him 505, he would have had no chance. He couldn't even say it.
No, he wouldn't have been able to do it.
But he wouldn't even be able to say, that's a 5, that's a 0, and that's a 5.
He would read this unfamiliar number out as the similar familiar number, if you see what I mean.
So if I'd shown him 505, he might have said 504.
Yes, exactly, yeah. So there was one example, the patient is French, and apparently in France, the common thing for doctors to check your breathing is to ask you to say the number 33. And so that makes it a familiar number to him. And he was shown the number 330. Which was unfamiliar to him, and he sat and looked at it and he said 33, because he was desperately trying to read it out, and so took this encyclopedic route, and that was the closest number that he could find was 33.
You didn't cross out the mathematical branch. Does that mean if I showed him two numbers, he would know which was bigger than the other, or?
Yes, it does mean that. He was able to do that. He still had the mathematical ability, and he was still able to tell which of two numbers were larger. If he was shown equations, he could tell you whether the equation was correct or not. You read it in a mathematical way, you kind of access these set of facts, but you still have to read it out loud. This patient, yes, was able to perform comparisons, understand inequalities, but he had still lost this branch, so he couldn't read the numbers out.
So he knew that 10 plus 10 equals 20 is correct.
Yeah.
But couldn't say 20.
Couldn't say it out loud. No, couldn't get to it. Unless for some reason 20 was very familiar to him. The number 19 he read initially as that's the age of my daughter. That's the age of my daughter, before finally getting to 19. If he'd have been able to do some maths that got to 19, then yes, but he would have been using this route and not this route to say it.
It's twice a day, really, that I have a good chunk of spare time when I take the dogs out for a walk, and that'd seem like a great chance to catch up on, say, the latest books. But reading and walking at the same time has its pitfalls. Don't worry, help is at hand. Crack out the phone and download an audiobook from audible.com. Now, Audible has a staggering range of books, and you can have your choice piped into your ears with just a few taps of your thumb. There are plenty I could recommend, but I'm not above being a bit biased, so why not look at these ones by people who actually star in Numberphile videos? And I'll put the titles of their books below in the video description. Now, if you go to Audible and you use the URL audible.com/numberphile, you will make these puppies very happy, and you'll be showing your appreciation to Audible for its support of this Numberphile video. Oh, and while you're at it, there's something in it for you. You will get a free audiobook, the free audiobook of your choice, maybe one of those ones I've recommended, when you sign up for a trial. Did you hear that? A free audiobook and happy puppies. What more could you ask? Check them out, thanks to Audible, and never walk into a tree again.
I'm going to do a not equal to, just in case you were still thinking that maybe Taylor might be my sister.